गुड मॉर्निंग, दिस इज़ द यूट्यूब चैनल ऑफ द स्टडी इंस्टीट्यूट फॉर IAS एंड माई सेल्फ अमंजा। वी आर कंटिन्यूइंग विद द NCERT कॉन्सेप्ट सीरीज। वी हैव एज यू रिकॉल वी हैव फिनिश्ड द हिस्ट्री NCERT ऑफ क्लास 6 एंड इन लास्ट लेक्चर वी हैव स्टार्टेड द हिस्ट्री NCERT ऑफ क्लास 7। सो वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू। सी द नेम ऑफ द बुक एज यू रिटन इट्स आवर पास टू द इन क्लास 6 इट वॉज कॉल्ड आवर पास 1। Now, this NCERT is focused on the medieval India, okay? And this is the list of contents. And in the first lecture, we had seen chapter 1, which talked about primarily two things. Sources, okay? What are the sources to study the NCERT? To study the medieval India. And there was something unique about medieval India. Uniqueness in the sense that the number and range of literary sources has exploded. Why? Because paper became cheap and, a lot many work and documentation and, notations were made in paper. So, for that reason, our source has expanded and changed. However, there are certain limitations that we are supposed to be aware of. If you recall, we had given the example of maps, we had given example of the change in terminology, we had given example in the change of context, that in which context it was written, etc. And then we looked at some major changes that we are going to focus in next chapters. For example, we talked about new social and political groups. New groups like the Delhi Sultans that represented the Turks, Mughals, some of the groups that become important in the early medieval period, called Rajputs, Sikhs, etc. So, and in these towns, traders, craft persons, tribes, nomads, settled communities. Here also we can talk about Jats, Sikhs, etc. And so then we looked into, contest or tension between regional dynasties and empires. Why? Because at the beginning or at the onset of medieval period, the regional identities had consolidated, and since a cultural identity inspires, political aspiration. So there is this, on one hand, the aspiration for regional autonomy, regional kingship, and then there is this imperialistic impulse. And this conflict had many manifestations. And then we looked into the changes in the existing religions and the advent of new religions. So those are basically the broad themes around which the history of medieval India rotates, and now we are going to look into next chapters. Today we are going to focus on chapter number 2. It focuses on new kings and kingdoms. Basically it covers the early medieval period. If you recall, we had talked about that first the history was divided into Hindu, Muslim and British. Totally haphazard, rather mischievous attempt to communalize India's history. Then the nomenclature was changed into ancient, medieval and modern, but the boundaries were kept. Later on, the historians realized that instead of looking at superficial political events, we should look into larger changes in society and economy, and therefore they even changed the demarcation lines, the boundary lines of ancient, between ancient and medieval and medieval and modern. So then later we came to a period when we realized that this 1000 year long medieval period is very cumbersome, very bulky, and there are so many changes that it is not logical to keep it in one single category. So medieval part India was divided into early medieval India and medieval India. Today we are going to focus on early medieval India. It was early medieval because many of the features of ancient India continued. For example, the phenomena of land grant that was contributing to the feudalization of Indian society. Not only society, but the polity, economy and culture as well, had continued from late ancient India. Okay? The development of temple cult, the advent of Rajputs, many such processes had continued from ancient India. Okay? And it acquired its full manifestation in early medieval period. So they had to separate it from medieval period. Here we are going to look into two important political events and economic and social dimensions of that political event. For example, first we are going to look at the tripartite struggle or triangular struggle, whichever word you want to use, between three important kingdoms for control over Kannauj. We will go into the context of that, don't worry. And then we will look into the Chol Empire. Okay, these are our two focus areas for this chapter. Now here, new kings and kingdoms. See, at the death of Harshvardhan and the decline of his Pushyabhuti dynasty, this was the situation that there were three important regional kingdoms or even empires. In South India, Rashtrakutas replaced the Chalukyas. If you recall, we had said the Rashtrakutas were rather feudatories of Chalukyas and eventually overthrew them. Similarly, in Eastern India, first you had Shashank of God, then they were replaced. There was a few century, for few centuries there was Anaki. The inscriptions of that period refer to that, the political situation as Matsnyay, the law of fish. They said that there was such an anarchy that the nobles and, prominent persons of that area elected a ruler who started the Pala dynasty. So there was Pala Empire. This was the core. See, we are only highlighting the core of each and every kingdom, okay? They had very large fluctuating borders. And then in North India, you had Gurjar Pratihar. Now, we are not sure about the exact origins of Gurjar Pratihar, and the origins they tell us is, open to interpretations that we will see later. Okay, these three powers fought for the control over Kannauj. Now, Kannauj, if you recall, was the capital of Harshvardhan. And at his time, it had acquired it had become a symbol. Apart from its economic significance, it was a symbol of power that yes, you are acquiring the capital of a previous emperor. So for the control over Kannauj and this fertile Ganga Valley, these three fought with each other, and there were numerous battles. It was kind of a triple threat situation, that if Pala defeat Gurjar Pratihar, then Rashtrakut will come and defeat them. If Gurjar Pratihar defeat Palas, then Rashtrakutas will again come and defeat them. So such details, or which war came after another, or which king fought whom, such things are not important. What is important is to understand that these three kingdoms succeeded. Okay, at the beginning of early medieval India, these three kingdoms were there. They were fighting each other for the control over Kannauj. These were their fluctuating frontiers. And look at some of the other areas. Ganga, Eastern Gangas. If you recall that originally the Gangas came from this area. Okay, this the area of Mysore, Shravanbelgola, etc. And then they migrated to that area. Okay, then you have Kaling, you have Eastern Chalukyas. Again, they were the successor of the original Chalukyas that were overthrown by Rashtrakutas. You had Chol. The Chol Empire, eventually they became powerful, overthrew Pallavas, and then they became for a while they had conflicts with Rashtrakutas, but eventually became the empire. Then you have Pandyas, Cheras. You remember the word Muvendar in post-Mauryan period? These three chiefs were called Muvendars. Although we are not sure about the nature of relationship between these Cholas and the Cholas of Mauryottar period, but they are using the same term to describe themselves. Utkal, the area of Odisha. Now, in our national anthem, the word Utkal comes. So, this is the word, the place Utkal. And these are two curious features. Arabs of Multan, Arabs of Mansura, or Sindh, Kashmir. Now, see, if you recall, around 710 CE, Arabs conquered Sindh. The Muhammad bin Qasim, MBK, let's say in short, okay? They conquered Sindh. Gradually, they conquered Multan as well. However, at this point, their march further into mainland India was halted by very powerful Gurjar Pratihar rulers. And on many occasions, rulers of North India and the rulers of Gujarat, for example, as a Chalukya ruler, Bhima II, After the decline of Gujar Pratihars, there were many small regional Rajput kingdoms. A ruler of Gujarat, Chalukyan ruler Bhima II, he defeated Arab forces. Arab forces often attacked the coastal areas of Gujarat and this part. Here they were also defeated. Often these other North Indian kings defeated them. So, this was the Islam via Arab people knocking at the door of India at this point. Now, though they fought incessantly for many centuries, but eventually all the three kingdoms declined and they were replaced by many small Rajput principalities. For example, Chahmanas, they ruled from Ajmer area and then they eventually acquired Delhi from Tomar. Anangpal Tomar was the founder of Delhi. We will see about it later. You have Parmaras. Here you had Chalukyas. See, there is slight difference in the spelling of those Chalukyas. Here you say C-H-A-U. So, instead of Cha, you have Chau, Chalukyas in Gujarat. Okay. Then you have here Chandelas, the areas of Khajuraho, Chhatarpur. These were the important, you know, important centers of Chandel power. You have in Kannauj area, you had Gadwal rulers. Okay. Gadwal rulers, Gadwal Rajput rulers. So, 5 to 6 important Rajputs came up in the, you know, post-tripartite struggle period. Okay. So, I think knowing this much about the political history is enough. So, just to remember some few important centers like Malkhed or Manekhet was their capital. Okay. Emergence of new dynasties. Okay. See, even before we had said that taking the support of powerful families of Samantas, Mahasamant and Mahamandaleshwar was expedient but pernicious. Why pernicious? Because the moment your feudatory becomes powerful, he will flag, he will, you know, fly the flag of independence. Or worst come worse, he will even, you know, contribute significantly to your decline. For example, the decline of, and also there was another one I forgot, Kalchuris of Jabalpur area. The Parmaras contributed significantly to the decline of Rashtrakutas. Okay. So, and we had already seen Rashtrakutas had overthrown their previous overlords. Cholas overthrew their previous overlords. So, it was very common that if your Samant, your feudatory becomes powerful, he will overthrow you. Okay. And how do we know that these eventually a feudatory becomes an emperor, a king or emperor? It is from their inscriptions. In their inscriptions, especially the ones in which they are making grants to the temples and, you know, making land grants to priests and etc., you will see a shift in their title. Earlier they would be called Mahasamant, Samant. Few years later they will be called Mahasamant, and then they might even acquire the title of an emperor. Okay. So this political fluid situation was going on. One of the important dynasty in this period was Rashtrakutas, that we have seen previously. Dantidurg was the founder of Rashtrakuta dynasty. Okay. Now he was originally a from Brahman Varna, and you know that the right to, according to scriptures, only Kshatriya have right to rule. So what do you do? He was a Brahmin. So he performed a Hiranyagarbha sacrifice. Literally it means golden womb. Hiran, not deer, golden womb. So in a way, symbolically saying that he is reborn as a Kshatriya this time. Okay. So basically by birth a Brahmin, but by occupation a Kshatriya. So, he eventually, you know, you can say it was rather a good subterfuge or rather good ruse to say that now I have acquired right to rule. There are many other origin myths. For example, similarly, apart from Dantidurg, Kadamba Mayur Sharman, he established, you know, a Kadamba dynasty in southern Karnataka, and Gurjar Pratihar Harishchandra, he was the founder of Gurjar Pratihar dynasty. The one of the important participant of the tripartite struggle. Now, the word Pratihar, it means gatekeeper. And they say that they are the descendants of Lakshman, who was the Pratihar or the gatekeeper of Ram. So, therefore, they are called Gurjar Pratihar. Now, Ram and Lakshman were kings. So, therefore, Kshatriya. So, they are Kshatriya. Therefore, they have right to rule. So, what happens is that an ambitious person can exploit prevailing political circumstances, and then retrospectively you justify your elevation to the kingship. There are many such origin myths. One such is Brahmachatra, means what they would do, that they will trace their genealogy through the Prashasti or through other biographies, eventually to a parent, where one will be a Brahmin, another would be Kshatriya. So, often they will be born out of a union between a Brahmin father and a Kshatriya mother. So, what it tells you is that on one hand, ground reality was very practical. Might is right. If you have enough resources to establish your kingdom or overthrow your lord or go somewhere else. Okay. I mean, Eastern Gangas went so far away from the original place of Ganga dynasty. Eastern Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas. So, if you have means, you establish your kingdom and then retrospectively justify your usurpation of power, okay, and then align your behavior with what scriptures ordain on you. So, this is rather, it tells you about the social situation. The point, the purpose behind highlighting these names and these dynasties is not to create an impression that you should remember these things. What I'm trying to emphasize here, that look, there are social processes behind these alignments and realignments. You know how we discuss modern day electoral politics of any state or national level. We often talk about the realignment of vote banks, that how a particular religion might vote this way or that way, or how a particular caste may have voted that way in previous election, but now that circumstances have changed, so they will vote this way. So, what happens that behind politics, behind power plays, there is this, a commentary on social realities. This is something very similar. Then administration in these kingdoms. Pompous titles to hide the decline in real authority. Maharaja Dhiraj. If you remember, even Gupta rulers were using the title of Maharaja Dhiraj, but they were certainly more powerful than these rulers of early medieval period. And if you go far back, as far as Ashok, he simply called himself Raja. Okay. So, more pompous your title, less authority you have. They had titles like Maharaja Dhiraj, Tribhuvan Chakravarti. How do we know? They have mentioned these titles in their inscriptions. See, we are talking about early medieval period at this point. Therefore, I have to emphasize that even for early medieval period, still archaeology is more important source. Okay? Coins, inscriptions, okay, objects. These are comparatively more important, but from proper medieval period, especially from the onset of Delhi Sultanate, the books and literary sources, they become important. If in the first chapter we had said that there is slight shift in the sources of the period, the shift is that the books have become important. However, that is more true for medieval period. As far as early medieval period goes, the inscriptions, the coins, the genealogies, the prashastis, they are more important source. Okay, but they had to share power with their samantas and brahmanas, traders and peasants. Okay, with the brahmanas, because after all they write you prashastis, they give you beautiful origin myths. Okay, they help propagate your royal ideology, etc. Land revenue as rent and taxes in kind from peasants and forced labor, etc. indicate feudalization of peasant society. Feudalization of peasant society and state. See, if you remember, we had talked about some of the impacts of land grant. Okay, how a peasantization of tribal society takes place. Another impact is that in inscriptions from, later Gupta period and early medieval period, we have seen that even labor was tied to the land. Labor was tied to the land. Meaning, whenever an inscription will be, issued, declaring that a particular land or particular area is being given in as a grant to a grantee, they will also mention that even the people who live on that land, either peasants, craft persons or artisans, even they are being granted along with the land. So what it tells you, that you are being tied to the land and you cannot move from that area to the or the other. Or if you want to move, you need permission of the grantee in that case. Also, so this is one example of feudalization. Another example is that since between king, now suppose you have king, here you have a Mahasamant. Okay, below Mahasamant, who has given more grants, you have Samant. Below Samant, you have large landlord. Below him, you have, occupancy tenant kind of people. And at base, you have landless labor that works on wages. Now, each person in that hierarchy demands tax from land, the tax from the produce of the land. And how they say, this tax is a sort of rent. The actual peasant has to pay it as a rent. Now, the difference between a rent and a tax is that, suppose you are paying income tax. You pay a tax to the state, saying that, look, state looks after you. It gives you law and order. It protects your life. And it gives you a certain sense of security. Okay, and many other services. But if I say that state takes rent, what it means that, okay, suppose you are a student, often you live in, rented apartments, you pay rent to the owner of apartment. So similarly, if a peasant is paying rent to his overlord, what it implies that overlord claims ownership on the land and says that since this land is mine and you are cultivating it, therefore you have to pay me taxes. So this is the slight, nuance between paying as a, protection money, that, okay, look, you are protecting my life, you are protecting my liberty, so I am giving you tax, and saying that, no, you own the land and I cultivate your land, therefore I am paying you tax. So often they had to pay rent, and that also in kind, okay, to your immediate overlord, and he had to do forced labor as well. Since you are tied to the land, so you cannot move, okay? And if you don't have enough surplus to pay tax, either in cash or kind, what you do? You say that, okay, out of 30 days in a month, for certain days, you have to come and work for me. You have to work on my field, or you have to produce certain goods and services for me, okay? And out of this thing, a jajmani system emerged, although they have not used this word jajmani system here. And they are giving one example that out of 400 different kinds of taxes mentioned in the Chola inscriptions, the most frequent one, vetti, refers to a form of forced labor. Okay? Mentioned in Chola inscriptions, obviously these inscriptions are talking about land grants and stuff. Land grants to individual Brahmins, to a collective of Brahmins or temples or some other groups. And Kadmai means land revenue. So A, land revenue is a source, principal source of income for state, kings, feudatories, and B, forced labor is very prevalent, meaning that the landless and the actual tiller of the land is very much tied up with the land. Feudalization of revenue collection as well as administrative machinery, we had already seen as far as Gupta Empire that people were occupying more than one place, offices had become hereditary. In fact, later on, even officials were paid salary in terms of land grants. So what happens? His son, who is going to occupy his office, he will get the same land grant. So eventually he will become a vested power interest in the society. So that is an example of feudalization. And often revenue collection machinery, say at the local village level, the largest landowner, if you remember an example of Gram Bhojak from ancient India, that he was both a sarpanch, village headman, as well as the largest landowner of the village, and also he contributed, helped king in the collection of land revenue. So what king does, that here we talked about a hierarchy. So how would king collect revenue from the tenant or landless labor who is working on the land of someone else? Okay, tenant come peasant. It will be via this hierarchy of intermediaries. King cannot send direct representatives to the land. So this is how feudalization has happened. And resources used to finance, how they are used? Simple, to finance kings and samantas' own establishment, armies and temple construction. Why? Because if you recall, we had said that temples at this point had become the this symbol of sovereignty of kings. See, temples started as a simple manner of worshipping your god as a part of bhakti. Earliest surviving temples belong to the Gupta period, though the temples before that existed, but they were mostly wooden structures. But from Gupta structure, both stone and brick temples exist. However, up to that point, they were not part of sovereignty. They were not a symbol of sovereignty. But gradually, the temple architecture became more and more grand. It became associated with the sovereignty of king, became a symbol. Therefore, kings often took keen interest in temple construction. I mean, here, whichever king you talk about, say Rashtrakoot. Now, a Rashtrakoot king, the famous Kailash temple of Ellora, it was commissioned by a Rashtrakoot king. Okay, Cholas, well known for their temples. Pandya, their capital Madurai was a temple town. There were so many temple towns, and at this part you had Chidambaram, you had Gangaikonda Cholpuram, you had Tanjavur. Similarly, Gangas commissioned a lot of temples in the Odisha area. Okay, Palas supported Buddhist monasteries as well as Hindu temples. Okay, same here in Gujarat area, you have Sun Temple and many such temples. So temple building now was not only a way of getting popular acceptance, but it was also a symbol of sovereignty. Now, prashastis and land grants, they are essentially a form of relationship between brahmanas and king, the thinker class and ruler class. Okay, the brahmanas wrote flamboyant prashastis and the kings rewarded them with grants of land where they had a large degree of administrative autonomy. As simple as that. Additionally, if the grant is being made to temple, that here also ditto control will be with the priestly class, obviously. Now that grant could be made to individual brahmanas and or to the villages of brahmanas, and they also had another utility. If you remember, we had talked about two types of village assemblies, Pura and Sabha. How donating land to brahmanas helped here, we will see later when we talked about Cholas. So often these prashastis are rather uncritical, and they are flamboyant in their praise of their overlord, either Prayag Prashasti or any example you say. The only exception is Kalhan's Raj Tarangani, and it is not a prashasti, it is a proper work on history. Kalhan was from Kashmir, and he wrote the history of kings of Kashmir. So Raj means, a chain of kings. It's a very scientifically written, because he has referred to inscriptions, documents, living testimonies, folklores, and using everything, all sorts of resources, he has constructed the history of the kings of Kashmir. And here, his praise of the kings is not uncritical. He often criticizes them, okay, when the criticism is due. So this is the only, it's a very different approach of remembering history than compared to prashastis, etc. And it's, again, it is a book. It was updated by later scholars. It is not an archaeological evidence. In fact, there are often questions they ask to critically examine Raj Tarangani as a source of, it's a very frequent question in mains, that to critically examine Raj Tarangani as a source of studying history, and there you say that since it is though a very well written book, it depends on variety of sources. However, there are some challenges. For example, especially when it is writing about the earliest kings of Kashmir, it depends on things like legends and folktales, etc. Therefore, for at least for that part, his history is slightly unreliable. Here we are looking at a copper plate, and you can see inscriptions on this one. Now, if you recall, in last lecture we had said that up to 700 CE, regional identities had emerged. Their own language, their own culture, you know, they had emerged. And one of the symbols of that, the now from that period onwards, the inscriptions were written in local language, or at best they were bilingual. That opening portions will be written in Sanskrit and later portions will be in local language, be it Kannada, be it Tamil, etc. One such example is this from Chol Empire. And what it says, we have demarcated the boundaries of land by making earthen embankments as well as planting thorny bushes. This is what the land contains, and they have given long list. He who receives the land can collect taxes from it. He can collect the taxes imposed by judicial officers as fines, the taxes on betel leaves, etc., etc. He can get large and small wells dug. He should ensure that water is not wasted and that embankments are built. So basically, it gives you not only revenue rights, it gives you administrative It gives you judicial, and from some other inscriptions we have realized it gives, you know, almost complete autonomy to manage the internal affairs of that place. Okay, after this we come back to the political history. We're saying for warfare for wealth and power, obviously kingdoms have tried to expand. Now they try to expand for various reasons. Sometimes it's entirely out of political ambition, sometimes it is for strategic reasons, sometimes it is for prestige. For example, the tripartite struggle was fought for the fertile and rich Kannauj area. Okay, it lasted for centuries. There were many battles, you know, the pendulum swung one way or the other. Currently, you need not, and not even currently, even later when you are properly studying history optional, there is no need to cram that who fought whom, what was the outcome, etc. That is rather superficial detail, okay? But then there is this another category of person, Sultan Mahmud of Ghazni. Ghazni is in Afghanistan. What he will do, he will launch repeated annual raids. Just after monsoon, they will launch raids. Why? Because summers have scorching heat of North India, and then monsoon, the traveling becomes very difficult. Now you have pakka roads, so you can drive on them. But during the time when you did not have pakka roads, even the, you know, roads will be lost, they will be washed away. Even the kacha roads will be washed away. So the monsoon and summer were not suitable for these people. But at the end of monsoon, with the beginning of winter, they will launch annual campaigns, specially targeting temples, so that they can acquire a huge amount of wealth. As you know, there were two points of attacking temples. First, that you get a lot of wealth concentrated in one place. Second, they were symbols of, you know, sovereignty. So you are in a way rubbing salt into the wound of the local rulers, that look, I came here, he conquered type, that I conquered, I took your wealth, you could do nothing. So both psychological and economic effect. One of his scholars, Al-Biruni, he wrote this book, Kitab al-Hind. And this book is written in a very systematic manner. Different issues are divided into different chapters. Okay, sorry. First, as you can say, this book is about India. Okay, this book is rather on India, and it discusses various facets. Talks about the polity, the society, the culture, the customs and norms, and the religions and the sciences, the habits, everything it talks about. And it talks about it in a very systematic manner. A, it was written in Arabic. B, they divide issues in chapters, and each chapter starts with a question, and then he gives his commentary over it, that what he saw, what he learned, what were his views. And to write such a work, you know, comprehensive book, he learnt Sanskrit so that he could read the sources himself. He conversed with many Brahmins. Although it is very unlikely that he ventured far outside modern-day Punjab. Many historians believe that he lived in and around Punjab area, and on the basis of his interaction in that area, he wrote this book. Okay. Here, there was even a question sometimes back that evaluate the Kitab al-Hind of al-Biruni as a source of Indian history. So, you start by answer by highlighting that why it is unique, that it's a very comprehensive book, talks about a lot of issues. However, you also say there are some key problems. A, it is entirely dependent on Sanskrit sources. Okay, so therefore, whatever is written in Sanskrit books, he takes them at face value. Now, even some of his observations are very unique. For example, he says that Indians didn't drink wine. Indians had long nails. They never cut their nails. They never cut their hair. Now, that's not possible. So, there are some weaknesses of this. Also, he never mentions the raids of Mahmud Ghazni, which were obviously destructive events. Okay, he uses the word Chhatri instead of saying Rajput. So, there are many inconsistencies in the book as well. But overall, it gives us a very detailed picture of the Indian society of the time. Okay, and then Chahmanas or Chauhans. Now, if you recall, when the Gurjar Pratihar dynasty declined, there were 5 to 6 Rajput kingdoms in North India. Chauhans of Ajmer were one of them, Ajmer region. Then they took Delhi from the Tomar dynasty, another Rajput dynasty, and from this core area they tried to expand into an empire. When they pushed south, they were, you know, repelled by Chalukyas of Gujarat. When they pushed east, they were repelled by Gadwalas of, you know, Kannauj area. Therefore, the conflict between, now see here, from this region, they tried to move east, they were repelled. They tried to move south, they were repelled. Therefore, they tried to move this way. And from this area, Muhammad Ghori, who had already acquired Punjab, etc., he was also trying to expand. So, therefore, they had a conflict over the Bhatinda area. And then they had 2 battles of Tarain, in which eventually Prithviraj Chauhan was defeated. Okay. Now, we talked about the tripartite struggle and its participants and some of the outcomes of it. We now look at Chol Empire. Again, the dates are not important. It is enough to remember they are a dynasty of early medieval period. Earlier, they were feudatories of Pallavas. Then they gradually became powerful, overthrew some of the neighboring feudal lords, and eventually established their own dynasties and started acquiring the kingdom of neighboring areas as well. Some of the important cities, see, Kanchi was the capital of Pallavas. Gangaikonda Cholpuram, Rajendravan established. Urayur was the earlier kingdom of Cholas of ancient period. Thanjavur was the new capital, Madurai capital of Pandyas. Okay, now look at the history of this area. Okay, Vijayalaya, who belonged to the ancient chieftain family of the Cholas, ancient family of, you know, of that post-Mauryan period. Although this is what they say in their inscriptions, but it is very difficult to establish that from post-Mauryan period, the Muvendars of post-Mauryan period right up till early medieval period, that family tree had continued unbroken. But this is what they claim in their inscriptions. It is, in a way, it's one sort of origin myth, you know, the way we described about Gurjar Pratihar, that they tried to link themselves with Lakshman. So maybe this was one of the ways of achieving legitimacy. We don't know. Family of the Cholas from Urayur captured the Kaveri Delta from the Mutariyar in the middle of 19th century. See, Kaveri Delta is obviously a fertile place, right? So a fertile place will have a large agricultural surplus. That surplus you can tax to build strong empire, strong army. That surplus will also inspire trade and commerce, craft specialization, urbanization, and all these things feed into a strong state, and a strong state reinforces these processes. He built the town of Thanjavur and a temple of goddess Nishumbha Suddhini there. See, he built the town of Thanjavur and a temple of, and in fact, often the towns were built around these temples. Nishumbha Suddhini, temple here, Thanjavur. Okay. You know, if you recall, we had talked about the relationship between construction of temple and the quest for legitimacy by kings. The successors of Vijayalaya conquered neighboring regions and the kingdom grew in size and power. The Pandyan, and then eventually, once they became kingdom, now they started acquiring the kingdom, the area of neighboring kingdoms. Like Pandyan and Pallava territories to the south and north were made part of this kingdom by Rajaraja I. He also reorganized the administration of the area. In fact, he was the one who erected the Brihadeshwara temple of Thanjavur. Now, the Brihadeshwara temple is dedicated to Shiv. Okay. After him, Rajendra I continued his policies. He even raided the Ganga Valley. If you recall, we have talked about that, how Samudragupta marched towards south. Rajendra I took the same route to march towards north. Okay. So he raided the Ganga Valley, Sri Lanka and countries of Southeast Asia. In fact, he built a navy specifically for that purpose and developed a navy for this expedition, so much so that the Bay of Bengal was called Chol Lake. That they had such dominance, and it is widely believed that the reason or the motivation behind this attack, you know, expedition to Southeast Asia was commercial, to control the, you know, trade route to China, to control the Malacca state, and etc. In fact, the modern word Coromandel, for the Coromandel coast, comes from Cholamandal, means the core area of Cholas. This is rather a corruption of the word Cholamandal. Okay. No, there were many other important kings in Chola Empire, and it lasted for a very long time, few centuries at least. But at this point, you don't have to know the name of all the kings. You don't have to know who came after whom. You just have to understand their overall significance in the history of India. Chola temples and bronze sculptures. Although there are many facets of Chola, many important things about the Chola dynasty. For example, the most important one is the autonomous village assemblies, although they sometime date back to the, you know, Pallava times. But during the time of Cholas, they became more important. Autonomous village assemblies. This is one key feature. Another argument or point of debate is the level of decentralization or centralization in Chola Empire. Okay. The extent of centralization. Another thing is how far the urbanization and traded commerce was going on. What was the quality of it? What was the quality of trade, etc.? So there are many areas of discussion, but right now we are focusing on only certain aspects. Okay. Chola temples and bronze sculptures. Temples became the nuclei of settlements that grew around them. These were centers of craft production. Temples were also endowed with lands by kings and other patrons. The income from this land went into maintaining all who worked at the temple and often lived near it. Priests, cooks, garland makers, sweepers, musicians, etc., dancers, etc. So temples were not only places of worship, they were the hub of economic, social and cultural life as well. There has been a question in recent past with a ditto same statement, that temples were the hub of economic, social and cultural life. As you can see, how this paragraph clearly explains that how it became a center. There is a clear link that king who seeks legitimacy will endow land to the temple, and that temple will gradually grow in beauty, in size and in overall social and economic importance. So much so that apart from these craft and art related activities, the temples would even invest their surplus into trade and money lending, etc. So in such a way, Chola temples, and partly Cholas are today known because of their temples, because the Chola temples are the high water mark or the culmination of Dravida school of architecture. Then Chola bronze images are the finest in the world. While most of the images were of deities, sometimes images were made of devotees as well. Images were installed in temples, including images of kings and queens. For example, the Nataraj image, the world famous Nataraj image. Okay, in fact, the image of Nataraj is kept outside the headquarters of CERN that runs the Large Hadron Collider in Europe. Okay, so you can understand. So the archetype Nataraj image, the archetype Nataraj bronze image, that was perfected during the time of Cholas. There is a technique called lost wax technique. This is used to make bronze architecture. I would recommend you to Google it and study the technique behind it. This is the Brihadeshwara temple of Thanjavur. See, the last chapter of class 6 NCRT, in the last chapter of class 6 NCRT, we had talked about the evolution of temple architecture. That it started out very simple, gradually one by one features were added. Gradually, from a symbol of, a place of simple worship of individual deities, it became larger, acquired economic and political significance, and by the early medieval period, they became a symbol of political sovereignty. How such evolutions happened? I'll give one example, that the earliest temples were made on a simple, floor. This is your temple, this is your gateway, if you pardon this structure. Then gradually they were made on a raised platform. And you have land, then you have a raised platform so that their profile enhances. Okay, and here you have temples, and this will be the gateway. Then they started adding, earlier the roofs were flat. Then they started adding, shikhar, and the shikhar kept getting larger and larger. Now at this point, the temple is, accessible from all the directions. But then you gradually put a pradakshina path around it. Okay? You put railings around it, around the main temple, and you create a pradakshina path. Then gradually the idea of a mandap came up. The mandap is this part around next to the main temple. Okay? See, this is here. Below this is the garbhagriha. Here is the shikhar. Now in Nagada school of architecture, this is shikhar. But in Dravida school of architecture, this is called viman. In Dravida school of architecture, this is shikhar. Okay. Here it is, rather pyramidal, but in Nagada school, it will be curvilinear. Okay. And then you have this garbhagriha. Here you have, mandap. During the Vijayanagar period, another feature called Kalyan Mandap was added, where important rituals will take place. Here you have Ardha Mandap. And then you have gateways. Now see, here you should look at this part. Actually, there are two gateways. Okay. One obviously appears slightly smaller than the one which is outside. What used to happen that, say once you have built a temple here and you have built the outer compound here, you have, gates in two or maybe four directions, and you live all sorts of settlements here. You are craft priests live here, other sorts of craft persons live here, etc. But then gradually this size of settlement expands and you need new boundary wall. Now the gateway, okay, the gopuram will become larger than the earlier gopuram so that people from far away can look at it. So more and more settlement expanded around the temple. They needed more outer walls, larger outer walls, and in each outer wall the entrance kept getting larger. So this is what we see here, the entrance keeps getting larger. Chola sculptures. Now this is the sculpture of a king and queen. Earlier we had talked about the Nataraj sculpture, and this is a sculpture of a king and queen. The Chola kings, you know, used to place their own sculptures in the temples also. And possibly, it is possible that they may have been worshipped on certain occasions. And due to this practice of putting your own image into temple, many of the historians have doubted, questioned the real strength of Chola kings. Because they say, look, just as Prashastis had, you know, very pompous titles, but they were trying to cover up for the decline in real authority, it may be possible that the Chola kings were not actually that powerful. And they were trying to cover up that, you know, lack of real political power with the help of this religious power. However, this point has been refuted because, look, if you don't have enough political power, there is no way you will have so much wealth to construct temples like Brihadeshwar temple. You would have, there is no way to have so much wealth that you can build a navy that, that conquers entire Sri Lanka, or you send expeditions to Southeast Asia, or you go on expeditions as far as Bengal and come back with, you know, the river Ganga water in, you know, many pots, right? So, but this one practice has, you know, in a way created doubts in the minds of certain historians. And agriculture and irrigation. You saw that the Chola kingdom started rising when they acquired Kaveri Delta. Therefore, it gives you some idea about the useful, you know, the role of agriculture in the rise of Chola power. So, let's see about it here. New developments in agriculture added to the prosperity of Chola state and society. Although agriculture had developed earlier in other parts of the Tamil Nadu, it was only from, here it becomes important, it was only from 5th and 6th century that this area was opened up for large scale cultivation. Okay, forests had to be cleared, land had to be leveled, embankments had to be built, and canals had to be constructed. Okay. In some areas, wells were dug. In other places, huge tanks were constructed to collect rainwater. Okay. See, what happens is that, now you know Kaveri Delta. Say, Delta has, you know, many subsidiary branches. Or they all go towards sea. Now, each year, especially during the time of monsoon, they will flood the nearby area. Say, flooding each from each subsidiary, and they are all going towards sea eventually. This is sea. Okay. What they will do, they will flood the nearby area. Okay. Similarly, now if in a year it's a lean monsoon, the flooding will be limited. If it's a, you know, very handsome monsoon, then there will be large scale flooding. So if you want to practice agriculture at the, you know, immediately near the coast, it's a problem. Though the land is fertile, replenished each year by, you know, the deposition of sediment, but it's a problem. The problem in the sense that it gets flooded each year. Very fertile due to flooding, but flooding will, you know, it would not help crop cultivation. So what you do, you build embankments so that even when river water rises, it doesn't flow over to the nearby fields. And what about the areas far off from the river bank? So far as the, you know, the flooding water doesn't reach there. So in that case, you built canals, you take canals out of, you know, main subsidiary rivers, and then using that canals, you fill artificial lakes and ponds, and then from those ponds, you take out another other branch canals. Okay, you put sluice gates in that one. In fact, some of the recently project was announced during the Prime Minister's visit to Tamil Nadu about the renovation of a certain irrigation project. And I read somewhere that some parts of that irrigation, Grand Aniket Canal, maybe I'm getting the name incorrectly. Some parts of that canal system were created as early as during the Chola period. So you use the local geography to your end. Now here you cannot dig, there will be very few areas where you can dig wells, because if the underlying rock strata is very hard, it's not possible to dig wells. If there is, you know, a natural depression in land, it can act as a pond. There you fill the pond and then take out canals out of it. So depending upon the local geography, the geography of Kaveri Delta and the surrounding area was such that from 5th to 6th century they could harness technology to start extensive agriculture, paddy cultivation, etc. in that area, and that will lead to economic prosperity and therefore the rise of state. In some areas, well, but wells will be dug in only some areas. It's not. In other places, huge tanks were constructed to collect rainwater. Okay. So, to remind you, embankments, so that you can prevent the repeated flooding of nearby fields. From the same rivers, you take out main canals, you put sluice gates, so that whenever the water rises above a certain level, it gets diverted to, you know, artificial lakes or tanks, or even natural tanks. From that tank, you can take out more canals. So, in this way, you can create a very, you know, intricate irrigation system. The purpose is very similar, to create agricultural surplus. Now, irrigation works require planning, mobilizing resources, and decision on how water is to be shared, obviously. Therefore, it requires governance, basically. It requires governance. Economic prosperity would not come without governance. Most of the new rulers, as well as people living in the villages, took an active interest in these activities. If you recall, we had done a small exercise in the 6th class NCERT, where we said that the king needs taxes to raise army, therefore he imposes taxes. Now, to increase productivity, you need to, you know, improve agriculture, etc. And there was a long list. So, something similar happens here, that for large scale projects, king will help you. But to manage it on a regular basis, even local level village assemblies have to contribute. And they would contribute, because eventually even their income is rising. Local people, especially the Sabhas, the Ur and Chola state. Now, Chola state will help you with investment and especially the large scale project. But the nitty gritties, maintenance and the local level projects has to be managed by these Sabhas and Samitis. What were they? Ur was the assembly of a non-Brahman agricultural village, and Sabha was the village assembly of a Brahman village, the Brahman settlement. Now, often in prelims, they give certain terms and they ask you to identify what it was. Okay. Similarly, we have created, try to point out some of the terms that may be asked in prelims, that Chola inscriptions mention several categories of land. Villan Vagai, land of non-Brahmana peasant proprietors. Okay. Brahmadaya, land gifted to Brahmanas. Shalabhog, land for the maintenance of a school. Devadana and Tiruna Mattukani, land gifted to temples. And Palichandam, land donated to Jain institutions. Now, they could use any of the five terms, though the Brahmadaya is very easy to understand. And even Shalabhog here, the Shala word gives you a hint of what it could be. Even Devadana to that end. But Palichandam, Tirunamattukani and Vilan Vagai, they could use these terms to ask you that what do they refer to? Are they coins? Are they units to measure land? Are they type of land? Are they taxation terms? So, you, since it's given in 7th class NCERT, you should try to remember it. See, we saw here that both the state as well as village assemblies took keen interest in expansion of irrigation. So, here let's talk briefly about the administration. Though there are many other facets of administration, say how a central administration is run, how then what is the level of feudalization, what is the role of ministers, what is the power of king vis-a-vis ministers, then you come to the provincial administration. Was it feudal or was there a homogeneous provincial administration? Then you come to district administration. But since the scope of chapter 7th and chapter, you know, the Chola chapter of class 7th is very limited, therefore we are only looking at the administration of Chola Empire in a limited way. Settlements of peasants known as Ur became prosperous with spread of irrigation. That is why they took keen interest. Groups of such villages formed larger units called Nadu. So, at the lowest level, you have Ur. Above them, you have Nadu. And maybe from this word, the word Tamil Nadu comes. These bodies perform several administrative functions, including dispensing justice and collecting taxes. So, they were, you know, fairly autonomous in their local affairs. And, you know, the state will regulate only lightly, not tightly. Velal peasants exercised. This was a caste of, you know, landlords. The people who had larger land holdings exercised influence at the Nadu level. And how do we know that? We say that at the level of, say, if this is village, then this is block. Okay, this is village, this is block. For the sake of clarity, I will have to highlight that they had created another unit of administration called Valnadu. You can call it, you know, district. And then you have state or Chola Empire. You have state, Chola Empire. Okay. So, how do we know that at the level of Nadu, powerful local peasants exercise influence? Because you have inscriptions. Now, those inscriptions could pertain to land grants. Those inscriptions could pertain to donations to temples or for some other charity work. Now, with people like Movenda Velan, it means the peasants that served three kings. Peasants. Now, in modern day, when we use the word peasant, you know, we automatically derive this image of a poor farmer. But a peasant is anyone who is the owner proprietor of a land where farming is done actively practiced. Okay. That served three kings. This is the word means. And arayur means a chief. So it tells you that since the administration at the Nadu level, which used to give, you know, inscriptions, give donations, give land grants, you know, give instructions to how governance has to be done. At this level, officials with the title like Movenda Velan and Arayur were given key positions. And not only at that level, even at the higher level. So, the idea is, here we said that for economic growth, you need governance. And in governance, the landed magnates played a very important role. This in a way also is a, you know, example of feudalization. When landed elements play role in administration, we already saw that these local assemblies had power over justice and taxation. It is not the state that dispensed justice like the modern state, but the local level power magnates did that. Also, a large number of Brahmin settlements emerged in Kaveri Valley as in other parts of South India. Why? And each Brahmadeya, that means a Brahmin settlement was looked after by a Sabha. Means it is the assembly of a Brahmin village. And it is about, we'll come to it later. First, let's see this point that we had raised here. That a number of Brahmana settlements emerged in the Kaveri Valley as in other parts of South India. Now, the first answer is land grants to expand agriculture. Second, to earn legitimacy, kings used to, you know, kings sought the alliance with Brahmanas. So, to please Brahmanas, they were, you know, given grants. And third, though it is a rather, there is some historiographical debate about it. But often it is said that superimposing a Brahmin settlement over non-Brahmin people or near the non-Brahmin landholders was in a way of the Chola, in a way of strategy of Chola state to counterbalance these, you know, local magnates. So that, you know, the authority of state is not undermined at the local level. So, but however, this debate, this is a historiographical debate and we are not very firm about it. But the first two options are clearly correct. Each Brahmadeya was looked after a Sabha, and then we had Nagaram. Obviously, as the name suggests, it was an urban corporate body to look after the urban governance. Now, if you have so much agricultural surplus, where would you trade? So, for trade, you need small towns. Now, among this web of small towns where agricultural goods are exchanged, there will be some larger towns or kind of entry ports where, you know, the trade between cities will happen. So, nagars will become nagaram, nutter, etc. So, the larger towns will come up. And here we haven't talked about the export trade yet. So, there will be some towns that will be dedicated to export trade as well. Now, this is the point that Brahmana villages will have sabhas. And if you remember, we had mentioned about the Uttar Merur inscriptions in the Chinglipet district of Tamil Nadu. The inscription belongs from Pallava period. There are inscriptions from Pallava period as well as Chola period as well. They give in detail the, you know, qualifications that one must hold to become member of a Sabha. Now see, one clarification, that these qualifications or the autonomous village assemblies that we glorify so much, they pertain to Sabha mostly. Okay? All those who wish to become members of Sabha, not Ur, should be, we are not that sure about the governance structures of Ur, should be owners of land from which land revenue is collected. So that means not, see, the office, you know, or rather the election to the office is not open to everyone, but you must be a landholder. They should have their own homes. They should be between 35 to 70 years of age. So you have both retirement age as well as, you know, recruitment age. They should have knowledge of the Vedas. Therefore, obviously, immediately the common man is cut out, the women are cut out, the lower castes are cut out. They should be well versed in administrative matters and honest. If anyone has been a member of any committee in the last 3 years, he cannot become a member of another committee. So you have, in a way, cooling off period. Why you have cooling off period? So that you don't become a local vested interest. Alright? Anyone who has not submitted his accounts and those of his relatives cannot contest the elections. So this is the Uttar Merur inscription from the Chinglipet district of Tamil Nadu. There, this Uttar Merur has a temples, and on the back, on the walls of temples, there are numerous inscriptions, and some of the inscriptions belong to Pallava period, some belong to the Chola period, and they give the qualifications to be a member of the Sabha. Okay, this is the important point. So with this, we wrap up the chapter 2 of class 7th NCERT. The rest of the chapters we will see in the later lectures. There we will talk about the two more important kingdoms, Delhi Sultanate and Mughal dynasty. Thank you.